That was about the most dignified way I could think to come out here, so. Welcome! Alright, you just keep an eye on that, make sure that doesn't go anywhere. Hi, I'm Matt Rose, and welcome. So we are going to go through a history of British music this afternoon. We're going to have a good time, as long as I can find my glasses. I know they're in here somewhere. There we go. Alright. So, today we will enjoy a trip through British music history with a sing-along at the end. Alright, so you'll get your cue. We're going to start with Lachrimae Antiquae, and this is by John Dowland. And he was born in 1563, and he passed away in 1626. He was an English Renaissance composer, lutenist, and singer. He is best known today for his melancholy songs, such as Come Heavy Sleep, Come Again, Flow My Tears, I Saw My Lady Weep, Now, Oh Now, I Needs Must Part, and one of his favorites, uplifting ones, In Darkness Let Me Dwell. His instrumental music has undergone a major revival, and with the 20th century's early music revival, he's been a continuing source of repertoire for lutenists and classical guitarists. Now, here's a big title to go along with this sad tune. Lachrimae, or Seven Tears, figured in seven passionate pavans, those are dances, with diverse other pavans, galliards, and allemands, set forth for the lute, viols, violins, in five parts. All right, I'm sure there's a short title in there somewhere. Now, this was first published in 1604, and it consists of a set of seven slow pieces, from which the composer calls tears, plus other pieces, including some livelier numbers. And we will be playing the first movement called Old Tears. And it'll feature some of those instruments that you never knew you were ever going to use, the recorder.
Thank you.
little bit more upbeat. And this is called The Arrival or the Entrance of the Queen of Sheba by George Frederick Handel. Now, he was born in 1685 and he passed away in 1759. So that first piece was Renaissance, and then now we are on Baroque. So he was a German-British Baroque composer, well known for his operas, oratorios, anthems, concerti grossi, and organ concertos. Handel received his training in Halle and worked as a composer in Hamburg and Italy before settling in London in 1712, where he spent the bulk of his career and became a naturalized British subject in 1727. Now, The Arrival of the Queen of Sheba is a sinfonia for two oboes and strings, and it premiered in London on March 17, 1749, as the first act of Scene 3 in the oratorio Sullivan. One of the last of Handel's many oratorios, Sullivan is rarely performed in its entirety, but Handel's bright and lively The Arrival of Queen of Sheba interlude is a widely appreciated processional set piece, and it is often and continues to be played during wedding ceremonies, unlike the previous piece, Old Tears, which has been played at a few divorces. All right, The Arrival of the Queen of Sheba. I was told not to go off script, so I apologize for that.
Thank you.
soloists, Nikita and Elisa, as well as our flutists, Zeno Flutist, Melissa Gawena, and Kelly. Very beautiful job, guys. Very nice. Very precise. All right, next we will move to William Boyce. He was born in 1711 and passed away in 1779. He was an English composer and organist. And like Beethoven later on, he became deaf, unfortunately, but continued to compose. He knew a bunch of people, Handel, Arne, Gluck, Bach, Abel, and a very young Mozart, all of whom respected his work. This is a suite of his pieces, but we will be playing the first and the fourth. W.S. Gilbert, 1836 to 1911, and the composer Arthur Sullivan, 1842 to 1900, saw the two men collaborate on 14 comic operas between 1871 and 1896, of which HMS Pinafore, The Pirates of Penzance, and The Mikado are among the best known. Gilbert, who wrote the libretti, the book, for these operas, created fanciful topsy-turvy worlds where each absurdity is taken to its logical conclusion. Fairies rub elbows with British lords, flirting is a capital offense, gondoliers ascend to the monarchy, and pirates emerge as noblemen who have gone astray. Sullivan, who was 6 years Gilbert's junior, composed the music, contributing memorable melodies that could convey both humor and pathos. Gilbert and Sullivan introduced innovations in content and form that directly influenced the development of musical theater throughout the 20th century. A medley of Gilbert and Sullivan.
Thank you.
not as fancy as a Coke, it's just tap water. All right. Okay, what is it next? Oh, this is a very, very emotional piece. This is fun. Okay. Now, this is from the Enigma Variations, and this is Movement 9 called Nimrod. This is by Sir Edward Elgar. He was born in 1857 and passed away in 1934. An English composer, many of his works have entered the British and international classical concert repertoire. Among his best known compositions are orchestral works including the Enigma Variations, Pomp and Circumstance Marches, Concertos for Violin and Cello, and two symphonies. He also composed many choral works, including The Dream of Gerontius, Chamber Music, and Songs. He was appointed Master of the King's Music in 1924. Now, Elgar composed his variations on original theme, popularly known as the Enigma Variations, between October 1898 and February 1899. It is an orchestral work comprising 14 variations on an original theme. Elgar dedicated the work to his friends pictured within, each variation of the 14 being a musical sketch of one of his circle of close acquaintances. The name of the variation of Nimrod refers to his friend Augustus J. Jaeger, who was employed as a music editor by London publisher Novello & Company. He was a close friend of Elgar's, giving him advice, but also criticism, something Elgar greatly appreciated. Elgar later related how Jaeger had encouraged him to be an artist, or encouraged him as an artist, and had stimulated him to continue composing despite setbacks. Now, Nimrod is described in the Old Testament as a mighty hunter before the Lord, and his friend Jaeger, that was his last name, Jaeger, that is German for hunter. All right, so German for hunter, Jaeger, and then Nimrod. It's a very beautiful piece, and enjoy Nimrod.
Thank you.
next we are going to, what are we doing here next? Oh, okay. So this is one that you will probably recognize if you see like music or movie trailers, and you know, like almost every composer, including myself, has stolen this from time to time. So this is Mars from the Planets, and in fact, let's see here, what year would it have been? 1994, and I was taking night school music classes at UCLA for film composing, and in my first conducting class, I hadn't had any conducting experience before other than just practicing the mirror. I said, well, I'm going to need something that's like just straightforward as can be. And so basically, I stole Mars and I put it in three. So just 1, 2, 3. So I just sat up there in front of these Hollywood musician guys. There was about 40 of them, and I was nervous as all can be. And I was, I don't know, like 27. And I just conducted. I stared straight ahead and just conducted in three. So pretty much the same thing today. I'm just going to conduct in five. All right. So Gustav Theodor Holst, born in 1874, passed away in 1934, was an English composer, arranger, and teacher. He's best known for his orchestral suite, The Planets. He composed many other works across a range of genres, although none achieved comparable success. His distinctive compositional style was the product of many influences, including Richard Wagner and Richard Strauss, being the most crucial in his early development. The subsequent inspiration of the English folk song revival, we're going to hear one of those things, of the early 20th century, and the example of such rising modern composers as Maurice Ravel, led Holst to develop and refine an individual folky style. Now, The Planets, his 32nd composition, is a 7-movement orchestral suite, and he wrote it between 1914 and 1917. Each movement of the suite is named after a planet of the solar system and its corresponding astrological character. So here we have Mars, it's marked Allegro, and has a relentless ostinato. An ostinato is a repeated portion for most of its duration. It opens quietly, the first two bars played by percussion and the clang of strings. The music builds to a quadruple forte, that means super loud, dissonant climax. Now, although Mars is often thought to portray the horrors of mechanized warfare, it was completed before the First World War. Now, we use this Calagno style like once every 10 years, and so does somebody have an example? Lorena, why don't you show them the example of your Calagno, and it's got a little British heart on it. So basically, and maybe give us a little example of some Calagno playing so they can look forward to it. Very nice. So in the early part of the 20th century, composers were starting to play with new and different techniques. Hitting the violin with a stick or your bow, of course, most of the musicians at the time, you know, would roll their eyes. But today we're going to do some Calagno, Mars. And now this is a marathon, all right? So just kind of sit back and relax, and you're going to hear a lot of music, and it's going to be pretty cool. All right, here we go with Mars.
Thank you.
Dan Reinschmidt. Oh, what a beautiful performance, guys. All right, that was loud. Okay. Now we're gonna class it up a bit with the English folk songs. Okay. Whew, I told you that was a bear. Okay. Now, Ray Vaughan Williams, one of my favorite composers, born in 1872, passed away in 1958. An English composer whose works includes operas, ballets, chamber music, secular and religious vocal pieces, and orchestral compositions, including 9 symphonies. He wrote for over 60 years, and he was strongly influenced by Tudor music, and English folk song. His output marked a decisive break in British music from its German-dominated style of the 19th century. Now, the English Folk Song Suite is one of Williams' most famous works. It was first published for the military band as Folk Song Suite, and its premiere, at Neller Hall on July 4th, 1923, conducted by Lieutenant Hector Atkins. The piece was then arranged for full orchestra in 1924 by Vaughan, Williams' student, Mr. Gordon Jacob, and published as the English Folk Song Suite. It consists of 3 movements, the march, the intermezzo, and then another march. The first march is called 17 Come Sunday. The intermezzo, which features Miss Ida on oboe, is titled My Bonnie Boy, and the final movement is based on 4 folk songs from Somerset. The English Folk Song Suite. picture of Buck and Solas with Tom on clarinet. So that's one that is quite remarkable. Thank you. James Bond Medley. The James Bond series focuses on the titular character, Mr. Bond, a fictional British Secret Service agent created in 1953 by ex-spy writer Ian Fleming. He featured him in 12 novels and 2 short story collections. The character, also known by the code number 007, has been adapted for TV, radio, comic strip, comic books, video games, and of course film. The films are one of the longest continually running film series and have grossed over $7 billion in total box office, making it the fifth highest grossing film series to date, which started in 1962 with Dr. No. Now, Monty Norman was invited to write the film score to Dr. No because the producer, Albert Broccoli, liked his work from a previous theater production. Norman was busy with musicals and agreed to do the music for Dr. No after Saltzman allowed him to travel along with his crew to Jamaica. All right, that's not a bad deal. The most famous composition in the soundtrack is the James Bond theme, which is heard in the gun barrel sequence and in a calypso medley over the title credits. It was written by Norman based on a previous composition of his. Now, John Barry would later go on to compose the music for 11 Bond films, and he arranged the Bond theme in Dr. No, but was uncredited. The James Bond medley.
Thank you.
our keyboard percussion back there. All right, we'd like to thank you for joining us this afternoon for our History of British Music concert, the third concert of our 16th season, and our 67th concert overall. We've been around for about 17 years. I'd like to thank all of you who made a donation as you enter. We'd also like to thank our concertmaster, Miss Tracy Ann Sprouse. Tracy, take a little stand up. She doesn't like the attention. Our librarian, Miss Emily Van Cleve, and our stage master, Mr. Kirk Harris, for the valuable help in putting everything together today. I'd also like to thank Mr. Arthur Larson and his best James Bond outfit. All right, turn around and go, ooh. All right, there he is, looking like a Swedish 007. All right, we'd like to thank our longtime sponsor, Core Rural Electric Association, and the town of Castle Rock, as well as real estate agent Ashley Simpson and State Farm agents Dave and Kate Topanaki. We would also like to thank our new sponsor, the Douglas County Community Foundation, for the generous grant, and thank you, Ida, for helping to move that along. As always, thanks go to Reverend Matt Franks, Teresa Keppel, and the First United Methodist for their patience in hosting our orchestra. We'd like to thank all of those in the orchestra who've contributed to the music and operations budget this season. And most of all, we'd like to thank you, our friends and family, for your attendance today. I hope to see you for our fourth concert of our 16th season at 3 p.m. Sunday, May 5th. Now this one's going to be called Bird Songs, and it will feature visits from real birds. All right, so you have to make sure that you're here. We're having Nature's Educators Bird Sanctuary from down in Florence. It's coming up here. They're going to bring some owls, some hawks, and vultures. We're going to also feature Mr. Beaker, a cockatiel, and one or two of our parrots from our friends at the Renaissance Festival. So make sure you're here for that. Probably don't stand too close, like right in this area. I'm just warning you. Maybe we'll have it like sectioned off, because you don't want to see the backside of that bird. All right. We're going to finish our concert with a fun one. This will end up being a sing-along, so we're not going to, pressure you, but you will be required to sing at the end. Okay, so no English rock band is more quintessentially British than the Beatles. Hey Jude was released as a non-album single in August of 1968 and was written by Paul McCartney, but credited to the Lennon-McCartney partnership. The single was the Beatles' first release on their new Apple record label. Hey Jude was a number one hit in many countries around the world and became the year's top-selling single in the UK, the United States, Australia, and Canada. Its nine-week run at number one on the Billboard Hot 100 tied the all-time record in 1968 for the longest run in the top of the US charts, a record it held for 9 years. Now, writing and recording of Hey Jude coincided with a period of upheaval in the Beatles. The ballad evolved from Hey Jules, a song McCartney wrote to comfort John Lennon's young son, Julian, while John went through some family drama. At over 7 minutes in length, Hey Jude was the longest single to top the British charts up to that time. Its arrangement and extended coda encouraged many imitative works through to the early 1970s. All right, clear your throats. Maybe you forget the song. You're gonna know when it's time to sing. I'll give you the cue, all right? I'm going to need a drink of water. Yes.
Nice story. She's got her Beatles show. All right.
Also features our lovely backup singers, Miss Abby Renee, and the lovely Miss Marina. Playing the part of Paul McCartney is yours to do. All right. That tap water tastes suspiciously like Coke. All right. Now, I've had a cold for a while, so Paul may be a little gritty.
Thank you.
No, that's fine. All right. Not like me. Thank you.